you said that he believes in one God at the most, and that's all. Well, I'll take it all. But you gotta have Jesus. Well, I'll take it all. They were the Presbyterians. Presbyterians, they believe it. But when you die, your soul goes up on the roof and you can't get it down. Presbyterians, right? Now, the Presbyterian, they're walking around with a frown, palm, the soul's on the roof, and they can't get it down.
Outside aisle so that we might have a record of everyone's attendance this morning. We would invite you to stand together and join in our call to worship number 297. I'm sorry I gave Marty the wrong hymn number. It's not what's listed in your bulletin. But number 297, Beneath the Cross of Jesus, the first verse.
Thank you. Small ball.
You'll make it work, huh?
We journey together this season of Lent, a time to reflect, a time to forgive, a time to repent, a time to remember, a time to recall. Christ giving through suffering, his death and resurrection for all. As we extinguish the fifth Lenten candle, we recall our desires of the mind, crowd out God's Holy Spirit. As a result, we deprive ourselves of God's gift of peace and new life. Through Christ, God came to give us that gift if we desire him instead of the things of this world. Five candles not burning, our minds come to Christ for wants and desires that build up the fires that cause us to die. As God's Holy Spirit rules over the strife, the turmoil shall cease in bringing us peace and giving new life. Let us pray. Father God, we realize that we get so caught up in the ways of the world that we forget your divine love and power. Help us to discover that wonderful divine peace that can only come from your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Favorite part of this job. I love it when I get to baptize somebody, even though she probably won't remember. We are baptizing this morning Parker, and I'm hoping I'm saying this right. Rander?
Rander.
I would invite you to turn your hymnals. Page 33, and we will be sharing in the baptismal covenant. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Mom and Dad, I've got questions I've got to ask you. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? According to the grace given to you, she can't answer that question. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
Amen.
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ, that we will surround this child with the community of love and forgiveness, that she may grow in her trust of God and be found faithful in her service to others. We will pray for her, that she may be a true disciple, who walks in the way that leads to life. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament. We believe in God the Father.
We
believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in
Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, and he ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe
in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The Lord be with you.
And I also will with you.
Lift up your heart. No. Too much by memory. Wrong liturgy. Let us pray. Eternal God, when nothing existed in chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. And when you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and this little girl who will receive it. To wash away her sin, to clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised from the dead, she may share in Christ's final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. What name is given this child?
Harper Allison.
Harper Allison, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Harper Allison, may the Spirit walk with you throughout your life and your name be in the Lamb. I've got to go take a walk. Harper and I have to take a walk. She's still asleep. That might be a first.
There we go.
Oh, well, not too interested.
Let's pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for Harper and for your work that you are already doing in her. We ask your blessings upon her. Pour your holy grace upon her. Walk with her. Guide her towards faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. And it is in his holy name we pray. Father, we come before you now with grateful hearts that We are born of water and spirit. Grateful hearts for your presence in our lives. Grateful hearts for the way that you lead us, that you watch over us. Father, we are grateful. Lord, we also come to you with concerns that are on our hearts. And we're grateful for the people that you place in our lives, but when they sometimes aren't doing well, we have concern. We love them and we want them to get better. So we lift them up before you now. We ask, O Lord, that you be with all of the names who are on our prayer list and that you now hear the prayers of your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We are grateful, O Lord, for all of these that we bring before you now. We ask, Lord, that you reach your hand out and touch them and bless them in a mighty and powerful way. That your work and your will be done not only in their lives, but in all of our lives. We pray all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us stand together and sing our praise chorus for this month. Give us clean hands with the words or on the screen or inside of your worship folder. Seated and let us pray. Almighty God, we are grateful that you are with us, that your presence reaches out and it touches us and blesses us. And Father, we are grateful for all that you give to us. And as we return a part of that now back to you, we ask your blessings on it, O Lord. We ask that, Lord, that you take what we give and multiply it and use it throughout all the world. That your Son, Jesus Christ's name, may be known to everyone. And it is in his holy name we pray. Amen.
be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. My Father's house has room to spare. If that were not the case, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When I go to prepare a place for you, I will return and take you to be with me, so that where I am, you will be there too. You know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas asked, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you have really known me, you will also know the Father. From now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father. That will be enough for us. Jesus replied, Don't you know me, Philip, even after I've been with you all this time? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I have spoken to you, I don't speak on my own. The Father who dwells in me does his works. Trust me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on account of the works themselves. I assure you that whoever believes in me will do the works that I do. They will do even greater works than these because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask for in my name, so that the Father can be glorified by the Son. When you ask me for anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. I will ask the Father, and he will send another companion who will be with you forever. This companion is the Spirit of Truth, whom the world can't receive because it neither sees him nor recognizes him. You will know him because he lives with you and will be with you. I won't leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. On that day you will know that I am in my Father. You are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them loves me. Whoever loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Traveling salesman was going down a rural back road in Alabama one day, and he found himself lost. And as he drove down this road, he saw a farmer sitting on a fence. And so he decided to stop and ask for directions. He said, can you tell me how to get to Montgomery? And the old farmer sat there for a minute, kind of stroked his chin. And then he said, well, you do this, and you do this, and you do this, and you do this. And the traveling salesman wrote down every instruction. And so he took off and he started driving. And he followed those instructions to the letter, and 30 minutes later, he was right back in front of that farmer again. And he said, I followed your instructions exactly. I mean, what's the idea? And the farmer said, well, I wasn't going to bother to give you the instructions to Montgomery until I knew you could follow basic instructions. Life can be like that sometimes. And when life is like that, it's not about us going in the wrong direction. It's just stuff happens. And it happens to all of us. There are days that we think, I should have just stayed in bed. There are days that we think, nothing could get worse. And then worse happens. This morning, we are concluding our sermon series, Why Jesus? The first week of this series, we talked about who is this man. We talked about how he was our Savior and our Redeemer, and how we remember that sometimes it isn't the Jesus of the Bible that we act like, but instead of our own version of Jesus. Something that we create in our own imaginations. Then 2 weeks ago, we talked about the company that we keep and how sometimes as parents, we will tell our kids, don't hang out with this one because we know that they're going to get into trouble and you're going to get into trouble by association just because you're with them. And yet, we have to walk that fine line between somebody that might lead us wrong who is not a believer in Jesus Christ and being able to reach out to those who are not believers in order to make them disciples for Jesus Christ. It's a fine line that we walk. And then last week, we moved on to forgiveness. And we talked about how with faith and with confession comes forgiveness. And how John wrote in his first letter that if we confess our sins, that God is faithful and just and will wipe away our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. If we are faithful and we confess it, that God will forgive our sins. This week we are talking about the path that we need to follow as people of faith. And Jesus said in the 14th chapter of John, in that lesson that Emma just read to you, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And out of that whole lesson, that's really all we're going to talk about today are those three things. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And Jesus continues that by saying, no one comes to the Father except by me. And by that, Jesus is saying that we need to follow his example as he is the way, the truth, and the life. I'm having microphone issues today. I'm not sure why, but the cord keeps pulling down. And when we start talking about the way, I mean, a lot of the time we think the way should be something that's really easy. I mean, I became a Christian. Shouldn't be life be a cakewalk now? I mean, God's on my side. And I mean, nothing should ever happen as bad to me again. And I think every one of us know how wrong that is. I mean, Jesus said to take up your cross and follow me. Now, one of the basic tenets of the Christian faith is that Jesus died on the cross. Amen. Nailed to a cross after he had been beaten. He was nailed to a cross. He suffered insults. If you read my blog, you can go read today's. It's about him suffering insults. And he suffered insults at the hands of virtually everyone around him. And yet, this is what we're supposed to follow. Because he says to us, take up your cross and follow me. Well, if we are going to follow him by taking up his cross, we need to realize that it's not going to be something that's easy. And sure as the world, whenever we start thinking it's easy, something in life happens that's going to make it hard. That's going to make it really hard. Because people around us, God gives us all free will, and people around us do things that are outside the will of God. They do them all the time. Is it God's will for someone to do drugs? Is it God's will for someone to drink and get behind the steering wheel of a car? Is it God's will for someone to pull out a gun and shoot someone? None of those things are God's will, and yet we always think that God's will happens in the world. Well, sometimes we get in the way of God's will. Sometimes other people get in the way of God's will for our lives. And as people of faith, we need to realize that things do happen. Paul says in his letter to the Philippians, to work out our own salvation in fear and trembling. Now, my wife is known already to our congregation for her love of evil math problems. And I'm actually going to stoop to her level for a minute. Not stooping real hard, because it wouldn't take long and I'd be out of it. But I know, without thinking about it, that 2 plus 2 equals 4. Am I right, Ava? 2 plus 2 equals 4? Ava, for those that can't see her, Ava shook her head yes. I need to check sometimes because, I mean, my math isn't good. That is easy. But if I have to take a problem and work the problem out, it is a great deal more difficult. When I was taking college algebra, did I ever tell you that I hated college algebra? Anyway, one of the things that we had to work out were quadratic equations. That's all I remember about quadratic equations, is they're quadratic equations and that there's a formula to do them. And at the time I was taking the class, I knew the formula, and you can work any quadratic equation if you know the quadratic formula. But then the professor started giving me this stuff about doubling the square, and I don't remember, it was mumbo jumbo cuss words to me. Somehow, some way, I got through it. But if someone were to hand me a quadratic equation problem, I mean, I could do the math. I mean, when it comes to the real stuff, not all those letters and junk, because words are made out of letters. Math's supposed to be out of numbers. But you take that formula, and I could do the math and work it out. I know that I could do that. But I would have to work it out. I mean, the difference between having something that you know and having something that you have to work out is, I know 2 plus 2 equals 4. I don't have to, I see it at a glance, I know I can give you the answer. You give me something more complex, I might be able to do it, but I'm going to have to sit and work it out. I can't just look at it and give you an answer. Well, when Paul says that we need to work out our own salvation, that sounds to me like there's a problem there that I've got to figure out a way to work out. But the good news of that is, I may have to work the problem out, but God's going to help me along the way. I'm not sure how much help God gave me in college algebra, but I know that God will help me work out my own salvation. But I also have to approach it from a standpoint of humbleness. Because it says that fear and trembling. Because we're standing before God. In 1968, Dionne Warwick recorded a song that was written by Burt Bacharach. The title of it was Do You Know the Way to San Jose? And I looked at the lyrics the other day, and I thought they would be good to share with you this morning. Just the first verse. Do you know the way to San Jose? I've been gone so long, I may go wrong and lose my way. Do you know the way to San Jose? I'm going back to find some peace of mind in San Jose. Now, I would challenge you for a minute and to remove the words San Jose and replace them with Jesus Christ. I actually rewrote the words to the song, and I did more changing than just San Jose and Jesus Christ. Do you know the way to Jesus Christ? I haven't followed in so long, I've lost my way. Do you know the way to Jesus Christ? I'm going back to him to have his peace in heart. It has to stay. Life can be so hard and confusing. We get pulled first one way and then the other. In a day, maybe two, you won't see the Father. Walking on life's wrong paths, they flash right past. We bundle life up into things. The thrill we have, it just won't last. You can really talk to Jesus Christ. You bow your head, he listens all the time. As Christians breathe, we also should pray the same old way. Through faith in him, I've left behind all of my crime. I was taught to him, I pray. I'm going back to him. Living in this way, I will not stray. Fame and fortune are both magnets. They can pull you far away from your faith. With God inside, you're not alone. Turn back to him. I really cannot wait. Then you'll see some brand new traits. What a friend we have in Jesus Christ. Do you know the way to Jesus Christ? Jesus says, I am the way. When we have to find the way, we look to Jesus because he is the way. And we really need to find our way. And Jesus goes on and he says, I am the truth. What does that mean? John wrote, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And the Word was with God in the beginning. Everything came into being through the Word, and without the Word, nothing came into being. What came into being through the Word was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not extinguish it. The true light that shines on all people was coming into the world. The light was in the world, and the world came into being through the light. But the world didn't recognize the light. The light came to his own people, and his own people didn't welcome him. But those who did welcome him, those who believed in his name, he authorized to become God's children, born not from blood nor from human flesh, or human desire or passion, but born from God. The Word became flesh and made his home among us. We have seen his glory like that of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. What John is saying there, in essence, is dedicated to the Trinity. I mean, Jesus is the Son. He is what over and over in that passage, John is calling the Word. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was God. And Jesus is the second person of the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jesus is the second person. So, in the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was God. And the Word, because again, Jesus is really saying, is himself. John is saying, this is Jesus. So, the Word was with God. The Word was in God. The Word was God. And it came into being through the Holy Spirit. That's all three of them. If we want the truth, we have to realize that the truth is found in God. In a lesson that we'll be looking at in the next couple of weeks, because it goes with Good Friday, Pilate is questioning Jesus. And Jesus starts to talk about the truth. And Pilate says, what is truth? It's an interesting question. And sometimes we don't want to hear the truth. In the movie A Few Good Men, Jack Nicholson plays Colonel Nathan Jessup. And at one point in the movie, he is on the witness stand during a court-martial, and Tom Cruise's character, Lieutenant Daniel Caffey, is questioning him. And Jessup asked Kathy, what do you want? Jessup asked Kathy, what do you want? And Kathy responds, I want the truth. And Jessup says back, you can't handle the truth. I mean, we say we want the truth, but sometimes we really don't. One of the things Cindy and I learned about our oldest son, he is honest to a fault. If you don't want to hear the answer, don't ask the question, because he's going to tell you the truth. He is so honest, it can be scary. And you better think before you ask, because you might not be able to handle the truth. Jesus proclaims that he is the truth, and if we accept that Jesus is the truth, then we accept him, period, because we know he came to earth to redeem us. He came for you and for me. He came for redemption. I was talking with the confirmation class this morning, and we were talking about redemption. And we talked about how before Jesus, there was all kinds of animal sacrifices. And to find forgiveness of sin, to find this redemption, took the blood sacrifice of the very best animals you had. And there was a lot of gross stuff that went on with that, like throwing blood on the altar. And I told him I'm glad that that is not the part of a preacher's job anymore, because I don't think I would be one. But it took that. Well, when God sent Jesus, when Jesus became one of us, when God became one of us to live the life we live, to live, breathe the air we breathe, when that happened, he came so that we might have life, have it to the fullest, have it abundantly. And if we accept that Jesus is the truth, we know that that promise, all the promises that God makes throughout the scriptures, are true as well. Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth. And finally, he says, I am the life. Jesus gave his life for us. He is our example. He is the way that we should follow through life. In his classic book, In His Steps, Charles Sheldon talks about a concept that you may have seen a few years ago, because it was kind of one of the hot things that mostly youth were doing it, but some adults did it too. That WWJD. Well, that is actually from a very old book called In His Steps. And in this book, Sheldon introduces, it's a novel, but he introduces the concept of what would Jesus do, WWJD. And when you... The basic premise is that whenever we're going through life and we have things that we have to do, decisions that we have to make, we stop and we ask ourselves that question, what would Jesus do? And then we live out the answer. And I would submit to you that if we were to stop and ask Jesus what to do, I mean, we're going to ask the way, the truth, and the life. If we were to do that, the world's going to start becoming a very much a better place, because love will triumph over evil every time. Not if it's one or two, but when all of us start living and start following the example of Jesus. When we follow the example of him, he is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. And we better not ever forget that no one comes to the Lord except through him. Grace is there, but that grace is found in the life of Jesus Christ. Praise be to God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son.
Together, a
big creed, having a
myself at the excesses of this world, taking only what I need for myself and my soul, seeking nothing for my own glory nor reason to boast. If I boast of anything, as taught by the Scriptures, let me boast in the Lord and in Him alone. May I indeed take up my cross. Let me accept the sorrow and suffering that is mine for the sake of others. Let me sacrifice my time and effort for the outfit of the greater good. As with our Lord in Gethsemane, I cannot deny, must express my sorrow. Nevertheless, I accept the will of God and understand there is a greater necessity and glory in the same and pain that I bear. May I indeed follow our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, this day, not for the sake of popularity or cultural norm, but because I have come to know Him for myself, because I have walked with Him and bear witness to His salvation in my life. Therefore, I drop my nets of earthly expectations and leave my tables of society standards to follow the Good Shepherd wherever He leads me. I am compelled by my love for the gospel and desire to live in holiness. I am merely a passerby in this world. There is a greater home that I seek to reside in. May my life on this earth inspire and lead others to the true belief and faith in God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our closing hymn this morning is hymn number 472, Near to the Heart of God. With the singing of this hymn, we open the doors of our church to accept members in any way they might come. By profession of faith and baptism, or by transfer of letter from another Methodist church or another denomination, the doors of our church are open as we sing number 472, Near to the Heart of God.